he is definitely one of the most important economists of our time. And he contributes to many, many subjects, fat tails, expected utility theory, catastrophes, and so on. And I would like to mention that his work had a tremendous influence on the recent IPCC report, the fifth assessment report of Working Group 3. In 2009, I invited Martin to our scoping meeting in Venice, and he is the one who deserves the merit that we have an own chapter in our report about risk and uncertainty, and that basically we frame the whole fifth assessment report along these categories, risks and uncertainty. So this was a very important impact. But I have to admit, so long before I started to think about the climate change issue, I came across an important paper, at least a paper which impressed me very much. Martin Weitzman has written, I don't know, in the 80s, I suppose, on profit sharing and on unions and workers' participation. This was the time when I studied economics, and most students at that time have been very left-wing. I was very interested in Karl Marx at that time. Then I realized that his labor value theory is probably wrong, and then I wrote Martin, and he provided a very important paper how profit sharing, labor productivity, and how stagflation could be conquered. So this goes back to the 80s. I have to admit, one of the most important contributions, at least from my point of view, is this book here. This is my favorite book. It is called Income, Wealth, and the Maximum Principle. So this is a book I started to read after 2003, after it has been published. And from that on, I recommend this book all my students. In particular, I recommend this book to our PhD students at the Potsdam Institute. The economists can learn a lot about this book, in particular, how to conceptualize sustainable development in the context of net national product, optimal control theory, all this dynamic thinking. And for the physicists, it's an important book because this book allows me to convince physicists that the Lagrangian multiplier has a real meaning in economics, which is also quite important. So in that sense, this book provides a wonderful summary of dynamic welfare theory, and I benefited a lot from this book. So in sum, I would say physicists, at least to my experience, physicists and economists can benefit enormously from Martin Weitzman's thoughts, thinking, and articles. So what can you do if you are not an economist or a physicist? I don't know. I would say it's your fault if you are not neither an economist nor a physicist. So, but the best thing what you can do is at least to attend this lecture. And you did this, and I think this was a very wise decision you made this afternoon. Now, Martin Weitzman will now provide a lecture with the title, Why is the economics of climate change so difficult and so controversial? I'm sure that Martin Weitzman will provide a lot of food for thought and will facilitate a lively debate. So we will have now a lecture between 45 to 60 minutes. And then after that, we have a discussion where you can make comments, raising questions, and also provide your thoughts about this interesting subject. Thank you very much, Martin, for coming, and the floor is yours.
Thank you, Otmar, for that overly generous introduction. Let me get right into this. I prepared something really more for an hour and a half of talking, so I'm going to have to compress now, which I will do. And I'll go right to the heart of the matter. I had more introductory material, which I don't have time to motivating material, which I don't have time to develop right now. You know, you might call this, if I were writing a small book or a popular article or something. You might call this an economist's apology. So I'm apologizing, at least on behalf of myself, and maybe on behalf of the economics community, why it is so difficult and controversial for us to come up with sharp recommendations about what to do about climate change. So why is this analysis about economist analysis a kind of an economist nightmare? I sometimes call the economics of climate change the problem from hell or the devil's problem. And the answer is, I think, if I have to sort of summarize it, that it's challenging at least a dozen basic tenets of economic theory or economic analysis. I don't think it negates them. I don't think it makes economic analysis useless, but in a frustrating way, it's pushing what economic analysis can do right against the wall, right against right up against great difficulties. So now what I'm going to do is very quickly, it has to be quick, run through a list of partial answers to this question about what makes the economics of climate change difficult and controversial. So here we go. So here's a race through a bunch of issues that climate change has that most other economic analyses do not have, and they certainly do not have this combination, this constellation of great difficulties. One of the enormous difficulties with economics of climate change is time. It's kind of ironic that time on a geological scale, what is happening is almost instantaneous in climate change. And that is a worry when it comes to uncertainties, because if we were to go to 600 or 700 parts per million, which I fear is the case from inertia, maybe more even over the next century or two, then that is... then to find a period in geologic history with that much carbon dioxide was put into the atmosphere that rapidly, you probably have to go back to 50 million, maybe 100 million years ago. Even now, at 400 parts per million, we have not seen that much carbon dioxide for some 3.5 million years. So the time scale is instantaneous from a geological point of view, which is worrisome or bothersome or creates problems with uncertainty, I think. And at the same time, on a human scale, the time periods are immense. They're far longer than any political cycle. This is seen by most people, I think, in the world as a rather remote problem, as a distant future problem. It's not yet felt, this would be my interpretation, at a grassroots level where the population of the world is pushing politicians and pushing the policy. Of course, there are some signs, but it's not yet felt at what we might call the grassroots level. And there is this human tendency to put off actions, especially under uncertainty, until some emergency is upon us. And now this question, are climate change catastrophes endogenous? Inevitable would really be another word. I want to share with you a pessimistic view. I partially have this, that in order to really cut back on carbon dioxide emissions in a strong way, there has to be this grassroots feeling that something must be done, that the average citizen is being affected by weather events. And if that's the case, and I fear it may be the case, then this makes climate change catastrophe or catastrophe, this makes catastrophes that are perceived to be connected with climate change, whether they are or not, almost inevitable. Because what will happen in this decade, if there is no strong weather or other event, catastrophic event associated with climate change, then we will go on. There is some holding back, but basically we'll not reach international agreements. And so the carbon dioxide level will go up. Then if a decade hence is the same or a similar kind of situation, we will then go on from 1 to 2 decades from now, continuing sort of a trajectory of too high level of carbon dioxide emissions. And this will keep on occurring until there is some perceived level at a grassroots level, until there is some perceived connection between something that looks catastrophic. And if that is true, or if that contains a germ of truth, then it is not so much a question of whether or not there will be this perceived connection with a threatening catastrophe, but when it occurs. That's a pessimistic view. But I think I fear there's some truth to it. Okay. From time, let me whip through some other things that make climate change unique, leave the problem from hell. Discounting, which of course is connected with time. The issue is that when something takes place over very long periods of time, and here there will be centuries before some or even many of these climate change impacts are felt, especially probably the catastrophic impacts, if they materialize, they will take place in the future, a century or so hence. So it throws an enormous burden on the discount rate and the question of how should future distant future events be discounted. And what difference does it make? It makes a tremendous difference. If we take a 7% discount rate, which corresponds to the rate of return on capital and stock markets over long periods of time on average, then the social cost of carbon, if you calculate it according to U.S. methodology, comes out to about $600 or so. About $1 or so. So if you take a 7% discount rate, the social cost of carbon is $1. If you took a 1% discount rate, the social cost of carbon is something like $600 or $700. So depending upon what discount rate you choose, you can get almost any answer. And that's bothersome. This issue of not knowing, on public projects what discount rate to use has always been out there, but here it is super important, and we don't know what discount rate to use, and there's lots of sub-arguments about what discount rate to use. Should it be descriptive, something that it looks like a discount rate there that is out there in the real world? Should it be pre-normative or prescriptive, in which case usually people from a normative point of view argue that something like climate change deserves a lower discount rate, and the discount rate isn't reflected in the real world. So there's that question. Even if it's a descriptive rate, even if it's rates that we look at that are actually out there, we have an enormous range of 1% for so-called risk-free investments. That's corresponding to something like U.S. Treasury bills or something like that. And then at the other end, you have this 7%, or you could make it even higher, actually. You have 7% or so corresponding to what capital markets are delivering over the long run. Well, as I've indicated, this makes an enormous difference. At a 5% discount rate, it will discount $1 100 years from now into some less than one penny right now. So it's really less than 1/100 of its value. Okay, so the long time period combines with the discounting to leave us very, or me, very uneasy And there are all kinds of technical issues here. There's a strand of literature that says that we should use discount rates that decline over time. There's a strand that tries to get at this question of what is the right data for climate change. What is the, if climate change is looked as an investment, is it correlated with the rest of the, are the benefits correlated with the rest of how the economy is behaving? Are they orthogonal, independent? Are they even anti-orthogonal? This will all make a difference. And that, and just on this discounting issue alone, you can get almost any answer. So why is it difficult? It's got this feature with long time periods and uncomfortable dependence upon what discount rate is chosen. Uncertainty. This is a huge, monstrous problem that's at the core of the economics of climate change. As I indicated, this much carbon dioxide this fast, if we go to 600 or 700 parts per million, hasn't been seen in, say, 50 million years. 400 parts per million, which we just swept through recently, 400 parts per million is higher. That level of carbon dioxide has not been seen since about 3.5 million years ago. So we're way outside the quote-unquote natural range. And that means we're really not sure about what's going to happen from a scientific point of view, from an economic point of view, with damages. Furthermore, the kind of, so it's way outside the range of normal experience, and there's a difference that's often, distinction that's often made between frequentist and subjective probabilities. So you can have probabilities where you know the process that's generating the uncertainty, so it's like flipping a coin. The flipping of a coin is generating the uncertainty, but we understand the process, and we understand that there's a probability of a half that a heads will arrive, and a probability of a half that a tails will arrive. And people don't like this; they don't like the uncertainty, and they're willing to pay to get rid of the uncertainty. They're willing to pay something like an insurance premium. When it comes to subjective probabilities, the public is even more at unease. The public hates uncertainty. It doesn't understand probability distributions. They want short answers, the public and politicians. And when you have this much uncertainty, we can't give exact answers. And you see a lot of this every day out there in the newspapers. Is there or is there not a human influence on climate? So these things are posed as zeros or ones. There is or there is not a human influence on climate. Temperatures are going up or they're not going up. In reality, what's out there is a sort of a probability smear of probabilities of various things. That's really the right way to look at it. But this doesn't assuage the public or politicians, and it makes everything difficult. When there are these subjective probabilities, and the probabilities about what will the impact of climate change will be are subjective. When there are these subjective probabilities, it's not clear that we have theories to deal with this. So-called expected utility theory is really based mostly on objective probabilities. With subjective probabilities, there's less sureness that we can use a theory like that, because there's arguments made that people don't like situations where the uncertainty, where the probabilities are unknown. These are called ambiguous circumstances, and maybe there's ambiguity aversion. So we're not sure. Because of all this uncertainty, it can, and it's subjective uncertainty, an answer can depend upon which model or which person is assigning the probabilities. This makes it look unscientific. The nature of this beast is that the probabilities, especially of extreme events, have to be subjective. But that can be make this labeled as not science. It's not confirmed by something objective. Okay, there's a feature that's making things much more difficult compared with a cost-benefit analysis of bridges failing, or of earthquakes. We have some frequencies, we have some lab tests, laboratory tests that we can do. Here we don't have that. Okay, here's another huge problem, as if this wasn't enough so far. Climate change, as I think many of us know, is a global public good. So there's this tremendous externality. It's sometimes been called the biggest public goods problem in all of history. And the problem here, so there's a public goods problem. Usually public goods problems are contained within a nation. So yes, there's a problem of free riding and of any one person not wanting to pay and wanting the others to pay because of a public good externality. But here it's international, right? That makes it 100 or 1,000 times more difficult because you have an international framework where countries are sovereign. And you have to get them to agree to something, to agree to emissions or a price on carbon. And that is very, very difficult to do. There is no overarching authority. If we went far enough into a regime where there were catastrophic outcomes or perceived to be catastrophic outcomes, maybe we would give up some parts of the sovereignty of nations. Maybe we would say, when it comes to climate change, look, we need something like an assembly or some decision mechanism that does not allow any nation to pollute as much as it wishes in the global commons. But we do not have this kind of overarching framework. That makes it very difficult. It makes it very difficult both on a theoretical level because the models that we have about global public goods are not very robust, in my opinion. You can get many different kinds of solutions. It's worthwhile pursuing, but they don't, maybe like the rest, is give us decisive insights sometimes. And aside from analytic problems, there is just this plain issue that there is, it is a global public good on a massive scale. So that makes the problem difficult and controversial. Now I'll go into some more whipping through. What are the costs? Well, this is probably a relatively well-defined area compared to the other things, but it's still a big problem. The issue here, I think, is that there are no off-the-shelf technologies to base load electricity, let's say, with the exception of nuclear, which has its own issues, and people, whether rationally or irrationally, probably both, object to nuclear. So there's no, the technologies we're talking about are technologies that are required to be developed, and that's an issue, so we're uncertain of the costs. What about the damages? Here is a much bigger problem, I think. Especially for high temperature damages or high carbon dioxide damages, I'm just listing some problems or questions here. How do you estimate these damages, especially at high temperatures? What is the functional form? Now, this is a surprisingly important issue. In the existing models, almost always the way in which damages are modeled is as if there is some evaporation of output or consumption. So without without temperature changes, there would be this output, let's say. With temperature changes, the damages are multiplicative in the output, and it is as if some part of the output or consumption has evaporated. Now, this is almost universally the way that that damages are modeled in the literature. There's some important exceptions. A problem with that bothers me a great deal is that this particular functional form, the as-if evaporation, makes it look as if it's easy to get high, it's still relatively easy to get high utility even with high temperatures or high damages, because you can offset that all the time by increasing the output, right? So there's maybe too much substitution between the damages from higher temperatures and the output levels themselves. The output of consumption, if we project past growth rates in 100 years, will be very, very high. There'll be many orders of magnitude higher than what is today, and it can then offset in welfare terms the increase in damages quite readily, even for reasonable damages. How do we include nature and biodiversity? There's an eternal question. Right now, we typically don't, or you just put in some placeholder number or equation. What is welfare? Do we trust the how should we model welfare? Well, there's a standard way of doing this with a kind of a representative agent and modified Pareto criterion, so-called. The justifications of the economist's approach to welfare, which is controversial anyway among philosophers and so forth, the standard economist way of modeling welfare it comes under more attack here because the justifications that we economists use to justify the criteria we employ to measure welfare, the justification is under more severe criticism. How do you combine different effects on different regions and different countries? Does the intergenerational aspect make a difference? Is that really a crucial difference? I mean, this problem is different from other problems because it's so long-term that you're talking about different welfares for different generations. In most applications, the results are within a generation. Does that somehow make a difference, or does it not? Okay, there are strong irreversibilities in climate change. And this is an important extra difficulty that we don't need, because it depends, because the effects depend upon the stock of carbon dioxide, not the flow of carbon dioxide. And the stock remains in the atmosphere for very long periods of time, there is a strong element of irreversibility. Once the carbon dioxide goes up, once the carbon dioxide is up in the atmosphere, then a very rough estimate is that 70% of it above 280 degrees, which was the pre-industrial revolution level, 70% of what has been added remains after 100 years, and about 40% of what has been added remains after 1,000 years. So it's a complicated, the carbon cycle is moderately complicated, but basically once it's in the atmosphere, it's in there for a long time. And if this were like sulfur dioxide, like acid rain, it would be much less of a problem, because it would make more sense to use a wait and see policy. Okay, let's see what the effects are. We're unsure of the effects of carbon dioxide. And if they look bad, we can just cut back the flow. Here, you can't just cut back the flow and have it impact the level of carbon dioxide. Can we learn enough about these impending catastrophes of very bad states in time to do something about it? I don't know. Now what I'm going to do is go into quickly again a couple of tiny bit more detail on two other features that are devilish features that are part of climate change. One thing is that climate change, along with a handful of other phenomena out there, has potentially unlimited liability. You really could fry the planet with a low probability under certain circumstances. Now, these, in my own mind, these catastrophic climate change issues, they arise and become a real worry for the high levels of carbon dioxide. So maybe it's not so much a problem now if you do some back of the envelope calculations, but when you get up to 600, 700 parts per million, we're now at 400, the back of the envelope calculations indicate an uneasily high probability, it's still low, of something really catastrophic occurring. So there are tipping points. One very recent tipping point that appears to have been passed is the melting of the West Antarctic ice sheet. But there are other tipping points, so if you go too far, you may trigger some process that's irreversible and that makes a clear nonlinear distinction. Okay, look, here's the key thing. Suppose that X is climate change damages here with some probability P of X. The key question, which is very hard to know, is how fast does P of X go to zero as X goes to infinity? So as you get worse and worse damages, how rapidly are the probabilities of these damages going to zero? If the probabilities are going to zero very rapidly, we don't have to worry so much about this tail event out there for very large X. If the probability is declining slowly, relatively slowly, the probabilities must go to zero. If they're declining relatively slowly, then we really do have to worry about catastrophes. And it's very hard to know what's happening in the tails. This is a dilemma, kind of a dismal dilemma. It's hard to get information about extreme events. Almost all of the probabilities here anyway are subjective. And there is some theory indicates that under certain circumstances, there is an extreme sensitivity to the fatness of the bad tail, right? So, for example, if we plug in our standard knee-jerk utility functions and the kind of a standard setup, and you grind the crank, if the bad tail is fat, meaning it's a polynomial decline as opposed to a much faster exponential decline, it can cause the social cost of carbon to be very high, and in some limits, infinitely high. So this is an issue, and I think that the lesson that's coming out of this literature, which by now is moderately large on catastrophic climate change, I think the overall message is a kind of a warning that when you have a situation where it is possible to have something catastrophic with a low probability, but not so low that you feel comfortable about it, you really need to include that in the analysis. And if that's not included in the modeling of climate change, you have to give an excuse or a story why it's not included, because it is capable, in principle, it could drive the analysis. So the insurance effect of investments, let's say, in mitigation and climate change, cutting down on carbon dioxide, the most important part of that might be that when you're cutting back on carbon dioxide, you're buying insurance against these really bad outcomes. And when you do these back of the envelope calculations, it looks like that might be the case. That might drive the analysis, or at least it's an important part of any analysis from an integrated assessment model or otherwise of climate change. This raises some issues, but maybe in the interest of time, I'll skip over. So I summarize, catastrophic climate change is a possibility. It's a low probability event, even at high levels of greenhouse gases. It's a low probability, but when we do these calculations, it does not look so low that you can disregard it, or that you can afford to model something without this feature. Okay, well, that's another. This possibility of a catastrophe or catastrophes is another aspect of this problem from hell that's making it very difficult, because depending upon the weight we put upon the catastrophes, the timing, when they occur, whether they can be discounted away because they're going to occur 1,000 years from now, or whether they can't be discounted away, this is a series of issues that does not arise in normal, ordinary, day-to-day cost-benefit analysis. Finally, I thought I'd spend a little time talking about geoengineering, another aspect of this problem from hell. It didn't have to be this geoengineering aspect, but there is, and it's going to make the analysis more complicated. What is geoengineering? Well, it's some sort of large-scale human alteration of the climate. And here, and there's a number of things that come under this category: carbon capture and storage, low-level clouds from ocean spray. But here I'm going to identify it with solar radiation management and simplistically equate the two. So I'll call geoengineering putting reflective particles in the stratosphere to reflect back sunlight. So it intercepts the sun, the high frequency radiation from the sun, and intercepts it and bounces it, some of it back into space. And you don't have to bounce back an awful lot to make a big difference on temperatures. Now, this kind of geoengineering, putting particles into the stratosphere, has been done throughout historical times when volcanoes erupt explosively. So when there is a caldera, there is a natural experiment. The most recent big caldera, big volcanic explosion, was this Mount Pinatubo eruption of 1991. That sent up sulfur dioxide around which coalesce particles that are reflective. The effect is immediate. It turned down global climate temperature by about 0.5 degrees centigrade immediately, and then it went away as the sulfur dioxide precipitated out after about a year or two. So this was a natural experiment. We've had other of these natural experiments going back further in time when strong volcanic eruptions have resulted in immediate lower temperatures. So it raises the issue, this is a natural experiment. What about an artificial experiment where humans seed the stratosphere with sulfur dioxide or other reflective particles? You can imagine specially designed, specially engineered particles. All right, now here comes the part that makes life difficult. This is what Scott Barrett, he's not the first one to note this or say it, the incredible economics of geoengineering. it's incredibly cheap to do this geoengineering, which cuts down temperatures. We're talking maybe about something between $1 billion and $10 billion a year to bring temperatures in 50 or 100 years down to temperatures today or temperatures before the Industrial Revolution. It seems hard to believe, but not a huge amount of sulfur dioxide or other particles are needed, and especially modified aircraft could do this. And even some rogue, it's been called Greenfinger, in a play on words from the James Bond Goldfinger, some country that wanted to do it on its own can afford to do it on its own. Now, geoengineering has lots of downsides, which in my opinion and that of most other, the vast majority, I think, of people who look into this think is too dangerous to use, make it too dangerous to use as a first line of defense. It will knock down temperatures, that is for sure. And it will do it immediately, that is for sure. But the oceans would continue to acidify because you haven't gotten rid of the carbon dioxide. Weather patterns would change, so maybe you could, if you're lucky, hit the right temperature, but it would cause diverse weather patterns. There's an issue about ozone depletion. There's an issue about dependence. Maybe people would depend on this, and then if you take it away, it's just as the reaction. If you take away, if it's sulfur dioxide, for example, and you do not continue to renew it, and the sulfur dioxide content drops, then the temperature will drop immediately. Right, so we discover something wrong, if we were to go out on a limb with this, discover something wrong with it, we can't back away from it very, very easily. The very feature that makes it attractive that you could get temperatures down in a hurry makes it unattractive if you really are hooked on this. Then there's what's sometimes called a moral hazard problem. It's not really moral hazard, but I'll use that term. If the public knew how cheap or learns how cheap it is, how inexpensive it is to keep temperatures down, maybe they will give up on this much more difficult and more expensive task of cutting down on carbon dioxide. And many people hate this anyway because if climate change itself was caused by too much human hubris, then this is hubris squared, because we engineered our way into this, we engineered the planet into this global warming, climate change, and now we're going to do engineering on top of that to get ourselves out of it. Okay, a lot of this makes a lot of people go crazy, and this too, in all aspects, is making everything difficult, this geoengineering possibility. Because who knows, there was serious talk of geoengineering, the worry of this moral hazard thing is that people will see how cheap it is to lower temperatures. But I don't know, I think it might go the other way. It would for me. If you see governments, research labs talking about this and doing something about it, it's such a scary idea that it would make me think, well, we really ought to pay more to cut back on carbon dioxide, and maybe it would have that effect on the public. So we don't even know which way this effect goes. Now, does geoengineering have a constructive role in a balanced portfolio? Yeah, I think we, especially as we keep going, we need a plan B, or we need several plan Bs, and it would be better to research this thing now and find out as much as we can about how it works, what might be its detriment, what might it be its bad effects, etc., rather than have this descend upon us. Again, the fear is that a country could unilaterally do this, and I don't have enough faith. There's still too much a huge amount of nationalism out there. Now, some countries, these are generalizations. So Europe, I think, is fairly responsible in the sense that they're paying attention to world opinion. They seem to want to do something about climate change. China and the U.S., on the other hand, I somehow detect more of a nationalist bent, that they have to be convinced more that it's in their own interests. And I could imagine them, or Bangladesh maybe, or some other country, unilaterally undertaking geoengineering because they are suffering. So look, these two problems, one is the problem with cutting back on carbon dioxide is the problem of a public good with a free driver problem. And the problem is that it's too expensive. Nobody wants to spend, or it's perceived as too expensive. Nobody wants to spend the money on this to bring carbon dioxide levels down. It's an expensive proposition. This thing is too cheap. So anybody could do this. So it's a public goods problem with the opposite properties, and it has what I would call a free rider problem, that anybody could do it. And so these two externalities have diametrically opposite properties, and I think we have to, and increasingly we will have to, look at climate change as a double externality dilemma. There's the public goods dilemma, and on top of it is the, or combining with it, is this geoengineering public goods externality dilemma. And I don't know how much this headache is causing, but you could say is twice as much of a public good problem as we thought before. I fear that this geoengineering thing will come more and more into discussion. And again, this didn't have to be. It's what makes this the problem from another component of what makes this the problem from hell. You didn't have to have it that geoengineering is so cheap that any nation could do it, or even a rogue billionaire could do it. It didn't have to be, but it is. It is. It is so cheap. All right. So, look, I've tried to explain why it's so difficult and controversial. What is to be done? I'm running out of time, and I will need to leave time for discussion, but the standard economist's answer is to put a price on carbon, one way or the other. If you had a uniform price, high price on carbon throughout the world, it would automatically generate the efficient responses. If only the rest of the world agreed with us economists. Okay, I in a longer talk, I would go through some more details on this story about putting a price on carbon and what to do in a world without a price on carbon. Do standards significantly help, and so forth? But I don't really have time. I think we should not give up on this carbon price. It's too powerful an idea. It's too it's too good a solution to just let go of it and give up and say the world isn't ready for this. So we should keep our powder dry, our gunpowder dry. Keep this notion of a price on carbon on the back shelf, but always there, and keep talking about it. There may well be a right time when this, a time that ripens when this could be pulled off the shelf. There might be a time when something catastrophic is perceived, and it's perceived that we need to break with complete national sovereignty. We need to have some overall treaty or way of dealing with this, and then here come the economists. We are ready with this notion. We've worked out the basic ideas. We've worked out some details. Okay, I'm done with this rushed tour. I hope it's been all right. It's just it's an economist's apology. It's a quick tour through a bunch of things that I hope make you appreciate why it's so hard for us economists to come up with decisive, precise answers. Do this, but not that. This amount should be spent on abatement and so forth. Thank you.
Okay, Martin, thank you very much for this very enlightened lecture and presentation. You have framed the climate change problem as a problem from hell, some training in philosophy and theology. I always thought I should be equipped to deal with problems from the hell, but unfortunately, modern theologists have a strong tendency to talk about the heaven and not about the hell. So probably we should change that a little bit, because we have to deal with this health problem. The other one was, I thought, this is this problem of infinity. This is also was a subject of theology, but now, meanwhile, it comes back into the economics, which worries me a lot, because dealing with infinity is also a very tough issue. Now, I would like to invite you to provide your comments and your thoughts, and then we have basically half an hour for discussion. Comments? Yeah, Rich.
Okay. It's awesome. Okay, thank you. My name is Richard Rosen from the TELUS Institute. I would like to congratulate Martin on an excellent talk. I thought it was a very much of a tour de force of all the problems we face. Of course, to me, the bottom line in part is that a lot of the modeling that's done for example, Working Group 3 reports and the IPCC work in general really needs to change. I think the lesson from a lot of this work is we need to be doing something very different for the next round, if there is one for the IPCC or other, you know, research here at PIC or wherever. So I think it's the uncertainties, as many people know, I've written a paper about uncertainty just on the cost side. To me alone, that means that we can't run economic models and be very useful for more than a few years. So I think we just have to pay attention to how to implement the mitigation of climate change for the next few years in a fairly, you know, least cost way, in a way that enhances human welfare, considering many other goals that we have, and sort of get on with it. The one comment I would have technically on the talk is on the discount rate issue. Since I think the streams of numbers that need to be discounted, or are discounted in fact in people's papers that result from their models, because the streams are so uncertain, I don't think the discount rate issue is an issue. I think there's nothing to discount, so it doesn't matter what the number is. So just on that technical point, I would say, you know, we can easily get rid of the discount debate, period. So thank you very much for an excellent talk.
Thank you. Would you like to respond?
Yes, maybe you could explain what you mean, just that the discount rate is not an issue. I didn't quite understand that, if you could briefly.
It's not an issue as to what the number should be, because if the streams of numbers, say if you're comparing a base case and a mitigation case scenario and you have some projected cost, if the cost is so uncertain, right, there's no numbers that are worth discounting. Okay, the streams of numbers are too uncertain, so it doesn't matter what the rate is that you want to use. There's no point in doing it in the first place.
I'm not sure I agree. I think I disagree, if I understand it, because there's a monstrously huge literature. Asset pricing, for example, is about this, about how to discount in the presence of uncertain outcomes. So in principle, This has been already conceptualized and much has been written about it, because if the benefit is uncertain, I mean, we certainly, if the benefit is uncertain, it doesn't negate discounting. It may affect the discount rate, but it doesn't negate the concept, I don't think. Okay.
Now, I have Linus.
So I like the idea of an apology. I wonder whether your apology is not rather a plea. Say a plea for a different normative approach, an approach that is different from the expected utility intertemporal discounting, maybe something more Kanchan, strong sustainability, precautionary principle, whatever, then pick your favorite. But I wonder whether it shouldn't be framed as an apology, but rather an argument against the standard normative paradigm of economics. Thank you.
Excuse me, you spoke rather rapidly, and I'm sure I understood it fully. What is the question?
So probably I can try to
translate.
So what Linus is saying, so he likes the idea that economists apologize for something, because in Germany at least, economists are always quite very self-confident. So, but in fact, he says, what you did is not an apology, but you made a plea for a different normative concept, a concept which is beyond the traditional expected utility theory. And instead of using expected utility theory, some formalization of a precautionary principle or strong sustainability would be much more appropriate as a normative framework for dealing with this climate change problem, if you think about the time, the discounting, irreversibility, and so on. So this was basically the question. I hope I translated well.
Is that all right? You agree, Linus?
Yeah, he agrees with my translation.
Oh, yes, okay. Look, this sounds good, sort of talk about how in the presence of uncertainty, we need a precautionary principle, and maybe we need an enlarged framework of ambiguity aversion and so forth. I agree that the present situation is unsatisfactory, but I don't see these alternatives as being precise enough or convincing enough to make me go in that direction. So I guess I end up thinking, admitting honestly to myself, look, I'm really not so sure what we're doing when there's so much deep structural uncertainty about the probabilities. But if I use an ambiguity aversion framework or a precautionary principle, for example, where do I draw the line? Do we want a precautionary principle that makes it catastrophe that makes the probability equal to 10 to the minus 10th or 1%, or ambiguity averse, a similar set of issues arise. So if somebody uses, so I gave an example from the precautionary principle. It's not precise enough to tell us what to do. It says to avoid really bad things. But what is a really bad thing? And avoiding it is with what probability? So this slips in through the back door. It doesn't, and with ambiguity aversion, it's something very similar. I'm sympathetic to the idea that maybe there is such a thing, although I think economists are more willing to generally to try to force things into some Bayesian framework. But here is the problem I have with ambiguity aversion. Typically, usually, if you say, okay, what does this end up with when all is said and done, ambiguity aversion? What it tends to do is to put a heavier weight on the really bad events. Right? So the bottom line is that with ambiguity aversion, go through some analysis, but put a much heavier weight on these really bad consequences. Some do this explicitly, and some ambiguity aversion approaches, it's implicit. Okay, so that sounds good, but what should this extra weight be? If you're just trying to avoid situations that are bad, it will creep back in. What is the probability? So imagine you are trying to advise somebody, and on the basis of ambiguity aversion, it turns out it looks like you should spend half of national income on avoiding climate change or avoiding something. And you if you try to explain what is the source of such a huge number, and you say, well, it's ambiguity aversion, we're averse to the worst case scenario, we're using some sort of precautionary principle, the very next thing that a decision maker would ask is, okay, you're putting a tremendous weight on the worst case outcome. Now, how likely is this worst case outcome? Are we talking about 1 out of 10, 1 out of 1,000, 1 out of 1,000,000, 1 out of 1,000,000,000? So when you try to go beyond, I think as a policy matter, when you try to go beyond ambiguity aversion, expected utility theory sort of comes in through the back door again, because you say you're wanting to put in a probability of how bad is this event. Okay, I hope I'm being fair to this. I end up kind of not being satisfied fully with expected utility theory, but not knowing what to put in its place. And I guess my own approach is to try to push this in a Bayesian way and make a Bayesian type story with expected utility theory rather than going over to some formal ambiguity aversion model, which I'm not sure I believe in.
If I may, I would like to share one thought which might, Linus, provoke a little bit in the other philosophers here. This reminds me when I read all the time this Kantian moral philosophy books, 800 pages they spent to explain us why it is absolutely forbidden to apply a utilitarian cost-benefit analysis. And in the end, in the last 20 pages, when it comes to tragic trade-offs, they come up again with some kind of modified cost-benefit analysis. So this is at least my frustration with that, and this is a little bit at the back door. All the time, utilitarianism and cost-benefit analysis comes back. So I have tried to kill this concept several times in my life. I was not successful. So now I have Felix. Felix, should I translate your question, or should I put your question on the table, because I'm quite sure I know what you want to say.
So, Felix Kreuzig from the MCC. Thank you very much for this impressive talk. I would like to come to the carbon price issue. Carbon price, I agree, is a wonderful solution. Nonetheless, I would claim that it can be at most half of the solution. And it should not be forwarded as the only solution. The reason is that we not only have a stock flow problem in the atmosphere with the CO2, we also have a stock flow problem on our stocks that facilitate emitting carbons. When we have a price signal on the flow of CO2 emissions, we don't address the stocks that we have, like coal power plants, cars. In an ideal world, of course, the price signal would trickle back on the stocks with a time frame of about like 40 years or something. Okay, but we are not in an ideal world. The price signal doesn't really work necessarily. And also we have like the political rationality economy that works in the other way. Because we have the stocks, there's a strong political power against having a price signal. And that means in another way that we also have to work politically on the stocks, on like the coal power plants and cars, and not only on the flows. Like this argument can be extended not to only to the physical stocks, but also to like our habits, like our mental stocks. Like we have a lot of habits that are ingrained that are not according to the like perfect rationality model. It's more like a heuristic rationality where we save a lot of calculation power and have our habits do what we think is good. And in the end, a lot of habits are ingrained and they don't modify easily with the price signal. It only works in a perfect rationale model, but not in like how humans often behave. So we also need to think at least about habits and what it means. So like at least half of the world is not successful susceptible to a carbon price, and we need to think about how to address these other issues. Okay, and like just a footnote to the uncertainty, you mentioned that uncertainty is difficult to communicate. There are new research in Yale and in Princeton on how to communicate uncertainty, and there are some possibilities of how to communicate and people understand it. Indeed, sometimes false certainty is understood to be like detrimental, and like they're perceived as scientists would like want to cheat the public, and it's better to communicate openly uncertainty in a well, in a good way. Of course, you can't do it in any way. Thank you.
I think I need my interpreter to translate for me again. What's the key question?
So there are basically two key questions here. The one is, Felix says, putting a price on carbon is a nice idea, but if you put a price on carbon, it's just putting a price on the flow. And he is arguing that we have a twofold stock flow problem, not just a stock flow problem if we accumulate CO2 in the atmosphere, but at the same time we have stocks, building up capital stocks, building up social capital stocks, and this creates a lot of inertia. Is then it is sufficient to put just a price on the flow? And do we need additional policy instruments beyond pricing the flow, which addresses, so to say, the stocks because of the inertia and the path dependency and so on? This is one thing. And the other one is, the second one is about communication uncertainty. But I assume that your first question is so challenging that we should focus on this one.
Okay, I've not really thought through this, because it's always been obvious in the standard models that it is sufficient to put a price on the flow, that basically everything can be of the externality can be translated down to, there is some price, the price will vary over time, there is some price on the flow that could achieve a social optimum. You don't need, that's overlooking a lot of things. You know, there's learning by doing, and there's innovations that need to be perhaps dealt with and separately encouraged if there's not enough appropriability of the R&D and so forth. But basically, in the simplest standard models, which translates into my standard way of conceptualizing this, it is sufficient to put a price on the flow. I've never quite heard this criticism before. If there is enough inefficiencies throughout the rest of the economy, if there's enough that's wrong throughout the rest of the economy, and maybe that's what you're getting at, then maybe more instruments than just this one instrument is required. If this is really part of some sort of theory of the second best or something like that, that the economy is already so distorted, but in a standard model where the rest of the economy, a standard situation where the rest of the economy is optimal, typically we think putting a price on the flow is sufficient.
Not yet, because it seems to me the problem is that he assumes implicitly there is not an optimal situation. So you assume some kind of additional efficiency. Okay, if this is not the case, you've got your next chance after I have allowed other people to respond. Now I have Christian Flaxland.
Christian Flaxland from the MCC. So thank you very much. Thank you on this excellent overview of the different sources of concern and the structural problems of the climate problem. My question is relatively simple. Do you see any structural reasons for hope or for support for putting a program that you sketch on this slide here in place, and what could be such structural sources of support for this kind of policies? So you basically mentioned grassroots activities at one time. If you could elaborate on that, I'd be quite interested on this and possible other structural supporting elements.
Christian, what do you mean by structural support?
So, reasons why a carbon price might have a chance of becoming adopted. So there were a lot of reasons why it not may become adopted, but reasons why it may become adopted?
Well, we had a conference. This was perhaps the main subject, but certainly an important aspect of it. Well, I try to mention, this is a top-down solution to have a uniform carbon price. I think if this problem were perceived, like as I've mentioned, on a grassroots level, I mean, everyone is somehow being affected by this. It's as important as the financial crisis of 2008, or maybe even more so. So that this is front page news much of the time, then I do think there would be a rethinking. If the U.S. was subject to a hurricane like Katrina every second year or something like that, I believe, even if that were not related to climate change, as long as it's perceived to be related to climate change, I believe that would cause a rethinking. So if and as the effects of climate change are felt, especially the strong bad effects, I do believe that could cause a rethinking and a more sympathetic attitude to the notion that we really have to sacrifice some aspects of national sovereignty. I think that's what's at play here. The nations are very reluctant to give up their right to do what they want in any sphere. I mean, we have some historical examples where this happens, but it's relatively rare, and to impose something like a uniform minimal carbon tax perhaps requires some giving up of sovereignty. There's been a lot of thinking on this by people who are much more knowledgeable than I am about where do we go from here. The price on carbon, if it comes in the form of a tax, that has a standalone quality that makes it attractive, which is that you are taxing a bad rather than a good like labor or capital. And it's also a world environment where for many countries now deficit reduction is an important goal. There too, you might think that this would interact with other reasons in making a carbon tax attractive. That's.
Christian Hirschhausen from TU Berlin. Thank you very much for this very exciting talk. I guess I agree with everything on pages 1 to 7. Except the footnote on nuclear. If there's anything we know as economists, is that nuclear has never, can never, and is not economic. But that's a footnote, which needs to be translated by Otmar.
It should be a footnote, because he's very outspoken about this.
Outspoken in the direction that it's not economic.
Well, if you show me one single plant in the world that has been produced. Okay, let's come to the question, which is on looking at heaven, which is looking at Eleanor Ostrom, who was invited to the climate lecture 3 years ago, four years ago. The question is why do we need one instrument? Why can't we have 1,000 instruments? For example, if we had only the carbon price, neither this institute nor this campus would exist, because this is a result of technology, science policy. The German Energiewende wouldn't exist because nobody would care about wind or solar. The shale low carbon revolution in your country wouldn't exist because it would be coal rather than natural gas. And why can't we think about several parallel instruments in order to broaden the scope for potential combating climate change? And then a concrete question, which relates more to your talk at the conference last week, but you can probably elaborate upon the possibility to differentiate the carbon pricing. between regions, for example, Europe having 20 euros, the US having $10, and India having $2 or one, and the potential effects, because your argument was price is better than quantities, many quantities, better to have one price, but the compromise would be to have several prices. Thank you very much.
Okay. Look, the idea that in some sense all you need is one instrument called the price, a uniform price to achieve efficiency, this is one of the miracles of economics. So this is one of the insights, I think, and it is a legitimate insight. It's subject to many qualifications, but this is what comes out of economics, and people who are not economists tend not to see this or appreciate it. Several instruments can also be dangerous, I think. They can be at odds with each other. An advantage of having a single price is that we are no longer in the business, we planners are no longer in the business of telling different industries what to do on the basis of different criteria. They will select by trial and error what is best for them, and what emerges is something that is socially efficient. So I'm reluctant to go over to having programs with hundreds of instruments or abandoning the idea of the attractiveness of one basic instrument. We're living in a world now where there are several instruments, and many of them are in conflict with each other. I mean, look at Germany. They're burning coal, and that's a big part of their future. Simultaneously, there are these enormous feed-in tariffs that are supporting solar in a place where it seems like it's one of the least likely candidates for using solar energy. So several instruments, I don't know. I see that offhand as being sort of what we have now, and it's sort of being dangerous, and the instruments can contradict each other, and they do not necessarily have desirable properties. And when there are several instruments, I don't know this, I don't know a theory that tells me about this, but my instinct is that you can subvert these instruments, that more easily, that different interest groups out there can get this specific instrument to their liking more readily when there are hundreds of them and you just can't keep track.
But before we now entering a debate which produces more heat than light, I try to translate it again. So basically what you are saying is, what should we do if we have additional externality in the innovation system, right? Is then a carbon price sufficient? It is necessary, but it's not sufficient. And I assume that you would agree.
Yes.
If there is an additional externality, this externality has to be addressed. There was one additional point. I was not sure if I got your point right. When you talk about different carbon prices, do you mean a regional differentiated carbon price? Okay. But this is something which seems to me should be discussed. So in your model, you have this median voter model where you have an inherent tendency for one uniform carbon price, ideally which would be quite close to the social cost of carbon. But if such a world climate assembly does not exist, and if we have different carbon prices across the globe, so then we have to think about transfers. And I got the impression that this was a little bit your question, if you might respond to that.
Transfers?
Between regions. So if India might have a carbon price of $2 per ton CO2 and Europe might be happy with $10, so what could be done? So under such circumstances, if we have different carbon prices around the globe.
But my own idea about how a carbon price would work, if it's in the form of a tax, let's say, the country gets to keep the tax, so there's no international transfers. I think that as an intermediate introductory mode, maybe it does make sense to have prices, different prices for different countries. So the form of an agreement might be that the developed countries put this higher price on carbon, and the lower and the developing countries have this lower price on carbon, more or less uniform among them. And the idea, the philosophy would be we're working toward getting a more uniform price. I don't see anything wrong with that. I do think it is useful to get people to thinking in terms of a price on carbon as a first step, to see this as an important concept, more so than maybe has been emphasized in the past.
Okay, Professor Allem, I have you on my list now.
Thank you. My name is Michael Alheim from University of Hohenheim in Stuttgart. So I'm not a specialist in this field, so I have to apologize if my question is too naive. If you give this talk in front of politicians and you come up with your conclusion, put a price on carbon and possibly a tax, they will love it, I think. But the next question will be, how high should that price be? So you have to come up with a number. And in your talk before, I had the impression that very convincingly you cut off all connections to between this price and the threats coming from climate change, because as economists we would assume that there should at least be some connection between the tax rate on the one hand and the problem we have to solve, that means the future damages and so on. And you showed us that we cannot say anything about the meaning of these damages today, because we don't know about the probability that they will come true, and we don't know when they will come. So what could be the contribution of economics under these circumstances to the assessment of a reasonable and convincing tax rate on CO2 emissions?
Well, this has been studied, what should be the social cost of carbon. And there was a US working group that came out with a recommendation several years ago that it be of the order of, I think, $23 per ton. And they revised this estimate last year to be something more like $35 per ton of carbon dioxide. It is, unfortunately, if you strip behind the scenes the models they're using and the assumptions and so forth, there is an unfortunate sensitivity on assumptions, especially the discounting assumption, as we've been through. It's very sensitive. The number is very sensitive to that. I think the idea would be, suppose you chose this $35 per ton. Maybe that's about the right amount. Maybe it should be higher. Perhaps it should be lower. An important feature, again, coming out of economics, that economics teaches us, is that in this case, with a price on the flow of carbon dioxide, this price should increase over time. And it should increase roughly proportionately with the discount rate, with the interest rate that's out there. So ideally, it's a trajectory of prices that is being implemented. I don't know how high the price should be, and I also am not sure what the quantity ought to be if we went to the quantity side. This is an issue we just do, and I've indicated today why it's so difficult. This is a perfect example of why the economics here is so difficult and controversial, because we can get many different answers, and it just seems to depend upon a lot of things, whereas for other areas of applied economic analysis, It's not rocket science. We can't get precision, but we have a much narrower range of what we think is out there. I haven't really answered your question. There have been models set up along with standard integrated assessment models that do come up with this $35 per ton. I guess that's all right to begin with. The models attempt to justify this by running a base case and then by running a comparable case where one less unit of carbon dioxide is emitted now and then seeing what the effect is on consumption in the future and then discounting it back by some rate to get a social cost of carbon. I don't know, I'm mumbling and fumbling here. There is no precise answer to this. There has been extensive modeling of this, and it comes up with this $35 per ton. And you're right to pinpoint that it's bothersome that we don't know what this is. Also, at this stage, I think it's more important, maybe more important, to introduce the notion of a carbon price that somehow is internationally harmonized. Maybe that's more important than the exact number to establish the principle.
I would like to add one response to Professor Alheim. So when we cannot carry out a cost-benefit analysis because of the inherent uncertainty, so that we could do a cost-effective analysis. And now here I would provide two important aspects here. We did this in the IPCC, so along the 2-degree and the 3-degree target. And it is very interesting, in the short term, the range of the reasonable carbon prices is so between 20 to 50 euros per ton CO2. Rich Rosen do not like the integrated assessment models for the wrong reasons, but this cannot be discussed now. I think there is a lot of criticism, legitimate criticism, and we should organize a workshop about this one. But it's very interesting, irrespective of the precise long-term goal, there is a reasonable range, which is around this $20 to $50 per ton CO2. So it's not totally hopeless what economists can provide to a public debate, a structural debate. So even if we have not the appropriate information available about the social costs of carbon, about the inherent uncertainties. So now I have one. You are the last one, Felix, and then we have tried, you have not the right to bring a new subject on the table because we have to clarify the old one. And for the old one, I would like to figure out if this is a misunderstanding, a confusion, or it is a deep problem. If it is a deep problem, then we are happy and we have to solve it. If it's a confusion, I hope we can sort it out within 3 minutes. So now the last one is this one, and then I come back to Felix.
Ja, mein Name ist Roland Zischang, Forschungszentrum für Umweltpolitik. Vielleicht darf ich Sie kurz bitten, sozusagen die zwischen den Disziplinen zu vermitteln, im Sinne vielleicht von einer Übersetzung, weil ich bin Politikwissenschaftler und nicht in dieser Terminologie direkt drin. Aber ich habe aus deutscher Sicht ein wichtiges Statement. Und zwar wirklich ist das Vorsorgeprinzip entstanden in Deutschland vor 20 Jahren, gerade vor dem Hintergrund aller dieser Argumente, die Sie entwickelt haben. Wir können nicht alle Aspekte, die mit Umweltbelastungen zu tun haben und die sich auf Ökosysteme auswirken, ökonomisch bilanzieren. Und daraus ist eben ein normatives politikwissenschaftliches Konzept entwickelt worden. Und das war auch relativ erfolgreich.
Okay, I think that's quite clear. So the question is about the precautionary principle. It's mm-hmm. a little bit related to Linus' mm-hmm. Intervention. Because Dr. Zischang highlights that this precautionary principle has been developed in Germany, like, by the way, the notion of sustainability from forest economists. So, and this is this precautionary principle. And basically he says, you provided all the arguments, you put all the arguments on the table which justifies the precautionary principle. Why not apply the precautionary principle? And we shouldn't be, your argument is we shouldn't be too agnostic about this. We have some normative concepts. If you allow, I would like to provide an additional interpretation, and this is the following. So Martin Weitzman talks about one catastrophe, the potential climate catastrophe. But he also talks about potential mitigation risk, like geoengineering. This is something between Scylla and Charybdis, so to say. And it seems to me, I personally, I'm fine with the precautionary principle, but my argument would be, and this is, I would like to put this on the table here, the precautionary principle does not help if you have only the choice between Scylla and Charybdis. What should then you do? The immediate question might arise, what is the probability of catastrophe one and what is the probability of the catastrophe B? So your basic argument is twofold. One, is the precautionary principle appropriate if you are faced with one catastrophe? And I would add and extend this. So what kind of precautionary principle thinking is required if we are challenged by two catastrophes?
Yes, this is a good, sharp way of putting it. I think the more general point is, from my point of view anyway, that the precautionary principle is not fully well defined. I can see it appearing in the form of we should make more investment to avoid terrible but that still leaves this quantitative question of how much more and how far down should we get the probabilities. So it's not giving a complete framework to get an answer. Should our level of precaution be 1 out of 1,000 or 1 out of 1,000,000 or 1 out of 100? And then there is this issue that Otmar is correctly highlighting, that if you have a precautionary principle on one side and a precautionary principle on the other side, how do you reconcile them?
Okay, so I think this is food for thought, and I'm sure that by the next year, the climate lecture, if you might solve that problem, and we would be quite curious to listen then. Now, the last question is now on Felix, again on the stock flow problem. But let me try to start to facilitate the debate in the following way. We had now an agreement, if we have just one and more externality, we need an additional instrument. So I think there's no need to repeat this. So then the one is about if we have a stock flow problem on the carbon dioxide, the flows in the stock, accumulation of CO2 in the atmosphere, and then you say we have other stock problems, stock flow problems. So like for the physical capital could be one. So what you are saying is you feel that this is an additional problem even if we have no externalities or even if we have no efficiency losses, adjustment costs or like that. If this is not the case, what's then from your point of view the problem?
So the problem is like I mentioned that we have these additional problems. Your response was basically that the standard model doesn't say that this is a problem, the carbon price solves it. My response to that is the standard model is wrong. And the point is that in the standard model assumes perfect rationality, it assumes perfect information, that it can be calculated, that we have perfect foresight, and that there's no risks on investments or disinvestments to some degree. Now, if we have that, if we have all of this, if we don't have perfect information, if we don't know much about the future, and we have a stock and a flow problem, then something called loss aversion or postback theory from Daniel Kahneman, which I'm sure you are very, very aware of, becomes relevant. So it's not limited rationality, it's like an enlarged rationality under circumstances that are broader than this perfect rationality framework. And that means that we don't have to talk about second best solution or something, we have to talk about best solution under like a broader rationality framework, and that means that, for example, standard instruments to regulate stocks become like the appropriate response to that. And we have to talk about habit formation because it's a problem that, or like it's a part of human behavior that is not really dealt with in the standard framework. And like, I appreciate your use of the standard framework to come up with like solutions on the carbon price, but you cannot assume that the world behaves according to the standard model, and if it doesn't behave, we have to see where it doesn't behave like that, and then think about optimal instruments for the real world that it has more than this dimension.
Okay. Martin.
Okay, well, you have your work cut out for you. You should produce a paper in this area that is very specific about what are these non-externality problems. When challenged to do so by Otmar, you're still giving a laundry list. You're still giving a list of things that are wrong. There's not perfect foresight. There's habit formation. There's so you're going outside. That's all right, the standard model. The burden is on you, I would say, to produce your own model showing clearly what to do. This is the strength of model production. You're forced to face up to being very specific about what these issues are about. For example, if you say that standard models assume perfect foresight, what are you going to impose in an uncertain world? Your own foresight to override? You're gonna have to make specific assumptions that are criticizable. Take that particular issue, for example. The agents don't have, which they undoubtedly don't, they don't have information about the future. Maybe it's probabilistic. And you're saying, though, maybe they have it wrong. Okay, well, what do you propose instead? Is it that you impose your own probabilities on future events, and which overrides somehow what or what? So I think we know that with the standard model, the flow is enough. Now, there are many things that could be wrong with the standard model, and you need to pin down a specific example and show and convince others that that it is relevant. Otherwise, it looks like a generic complaint that the standard model is incomplete or no good, and this is the way I'm understanding your argument. And then in that case, we need extra instruments. So it looks like it's this issue of externalities not being taken account of or something like that.
So I provide now a title for your next paper. And the title is CO2 pricing sufficient when future markets are incomplete? Because it seems to me you are talking very much that if some kind of risk, some kind of gains in the future cannot be discounted properly to the current, and this might be one way to think about this. But the burden is indeed on you. Now, thank you very much. Fine with that. But now we have to come to an end, and I would like to ask you to join me to give Marty Weitzman a big hand for a great talk and a great presentation.